What a haul it's been, I'll tell you. Especially for the book. I mean, when I was 17 and went to college, if somebody had told me that I was going to be 65 before I had a book, and I would have no degrees, I would not have believed them. I would have bet, you know, just about anything against that. It was just like impossible it would turn out that way, but so it did turn out. And so, you know, this book, I started writing it in 1978. And what were chapters became volumes. And, you know, it was just because it was like this subject, trying to uncover, to decolonize Europe and uncover the female histories and the common woman's histories, as Judy has shown us, the common woman. This is the core, this is the center of everything. It was a really long, long undertaking because this knowledge has, first when I began, I just thought, well, they just destroyed it all. It's gone, you know, they wrecked it. And over time, as I was collecting, I found more and more and more and more. And it's like, oh, this is, wow, look at this, look at this. But what they did is they ripped it in, they took the web of culture and they tore it into smithereens. And there's little strands over here and little strands buried there. And most of it is sequestrated in libraries where only specialist scholars ever see it. It's in languages other than English, you know, and so it really takes a lot of digging. Now, when you look at this book, those of you who have bought it, it's dense, I admit that, you know, because I had to really document it, you know, and so that involves going into linguistics, it involves the arcane world of medieval history, and all of this stuff. And so what my goal was, and you will be the judge of whether I succeeded in it, is to try and make that accessible. You know, so we're really spanning audiences here because I annotated it for the scholars, so I've got all the proof in there, but I want regular people to be able to read it. So I tried not to make it to academies. And anyway, so there's a lot of things that I was really excited to find in this. I hoped to have the book done a year ago, and I was up in Sebastopol to do a slideshow, and I was visiting Joan Marler. Some of you may know her work as someone who's worked with Maria Gimbutas, and the biographer of Maria Gimbutas, and in some ways her successor. And so I was really stoked to actually visit her library, which she has some of Maria's books in that library as well. And so I'm looking through this library, and she had a tome, I swear to you, it was this thick, on archaeology of world archaeology. And one of the articles in there was by someone I had never heard of, but my eye was immediately drawn to reconstructions of Norse seeresses, that they've actually had archaeological finds of them. And there were pictures of them and their ceremonial staves. Now, I had found a few photos of the staves, but this was a lot. And I was able to track down a PDF of this man's dissertation. And really, it just took me in this whole other direction, which was really the final piece in what the case that I'm making in this book has a lot to do with the substance of women's culture in Europe. It has to do with the goddesses, the fates, the witches. One of the really important symbols that are involved is that of the spinner and the weaver, the cosmic weaver, the weaver of destiny. And so that's the Norns, it's Weird or the Three Weird Sisters, it's the Fatas, and later on in language it changes to fairies, right? There's all these names that migrate on the tongues of peoples over long periods of time. And so the missing piece was that the Völler, the seeresses in Scandinavia, that title means staff woman. We knew that they had staffs, and we knew from the sagas and the Icelandic Edda that these staffs were really important shamanic power objects in that ceremony. But what I did not know, and it took me a little longer to figure this out, was that those staffs symbolized the distaff, which is a spinning tool that women use. Mm-hmm. And so I'm puzzling over the pictures of these staffs because they go like this. There's a staff, and then it branches out into spokes, and then it joins up and finishes the staff. I'm looking at that. You can see them in the fourth chapter of this book. I have many pictures that I had to draw by hand in order to get them in here. But I'm looking at them and going, what is that? What could that be? It's something. It's not there for no reason. What is it? And then I was researching online, and I found an article by a Norwegian archaeologist, and he said they represent the distaff. So I mean, began Googling around and getting pictures of distaff, and sure enough, it's exactly what it was. There's no possibility of it being anything else. It represented the distaff. And so the distaff is a symbol of female authority and power. And you have a lot of proverbs, all the way going back to the ancient Greeks, you see goddesses holding distaffs. And then in the witch hunts, you see women holding distaffs as the symbol, you know, this is for those who are being persecuted, because powerful women were the target in witch hunts. So, all that intro, but just to say, you know, there's a lot of pieces that came together almost at the last minute and tied everything together. All right, I'm going to read a little bit here, because this is one of the most exciting things that I found. And I talk a lot about the information that I'm using in this book. A lot of it comes from the church in its attempts to stamp out the witches and to stamp out the heathen cultures. They wrote handbooks to educate them each other about what to look for and to interrogate the peasantry with. Is there any woman who, and then there would be a list of things, does she make offerings to the fates, or does she do this, that, or the other? So one of these penitential books, interrogatories, would you call them, was written by a man in northern France in the 800s. And a couple hundred years after that, this piece, and I'm going to read it to you, was translated by an Anglo-Saxon translator. And so I'm going to add in the piece that he says, because he's basically explaining to his audience what is meant here. So first, in the French version, some are so blind that they bring their offerings to earth-fast stone, and also to trees and to wellsprings, and will not understand how stupidly they act, and blah, 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 and then it goes off into the, you know, into the priestcraft of telling people how ignorant and backward they are for not believing in the one true monotheistic male god. But the Anglo-Saxon translator, this is 1,000 years ago from our time, took that and added a revealing phrase. He contextualized the passage by adding it to it, Swawikan Tacha, as the witches teach. They bring to their offerings to earth-fast stone, and also to trees and wellsprings, as the witches teach. And so this is so important, because it's an acknowledgement from the horse's mouth of the very repressors themselves, of the fact that the witches were animistic, earth-based spiritual practice. The same as every other part of the world, they were honoring the waters as the wellspring of life, the trees and the stones. And so this is one of many things in this book and the volumes to follow that show how Europe was connected with the rest of the world in their animist philosophy and their ancestor veneration, which is another thing that I develop in the following chapter from this.